Sylvanas patted her captive on the shoulder, causing Stefan to recoil against her touch. I am told that since taking knightly oath, your dear cousin has patrolled the plague lands near that old farm of yours. He took down no small number of our people in the process. Her voice turned to ice as she leaned in closer to a prisoner. I could have ordered my dark rangers to end his life, of course, but it's fortunate I never got around to do that. Now this paladin will serve a greater purpose. I'll never join you, Stefan swore through gritted teeth. Not to worry, cousin, Nefano said, his words dark and heavy. That's not what she has in mind. The Banshee Queen smiled. Not exactly. Sylvana said no more as she sauntered away. As he peered down at his cousin, helpless before him, a wave of something unfamiliar rose up in Nefano's chest. Pity? No, he knew he was incapable of that. But he didn't hate the paladin, not the way he hated other living men. It was pride, he realized. Part of him was actually proud that Stefan had fulfilled the dream that he clung as to a boy, even if that dream was about to be undone. Nefanos looked up at Sylvanas and met her gaze. Was this the true test? Did she suspect the love for his cousin might move him to betray her? Did she wonder if he, in the moment of decision, might give up on everything in one final, desperate glimmer of humanity? But of course, there was no choice. The whims of a man long dead could not sway Nefano's Blightcaller from his oath. Let us be about it then, he barked as he made his way to the empty altar. The light will save me, Stefan called out. But the desperation creeping into his voice made him a liar. The light cannot find you here, boy, Nefano's answered, eyes fixed upon his queen. Together, we will embrace the darkness. Soundlessly, the Valkyr glided to a halt between the struggling human and the undead. Nefanos glared up at the maiden, his grim visage a mask concealing the pangs of hesitation curdling inside of him. With wings spread wide and arms raised, the Valkyr seemed to fill the entire chamber. She chanted words in an ancient tongue, her voice a harrowing dirge that still echoed with the Lich King's power. The specter loomed over the stone slabs, flashes of blue and gold pulsing from her hands. With his teeth bared, Nefanos' world exploded in a cacophony of fire and pain. So much pain. When the tide of agony receded and his wits returned, Nefanos' eyes flickered open and the room took shape. The Valkyr knelt in one corner. The creature, who had seemed so immense and implacable, now appeared small and defenseless. The Dark Lady stood near him. How do you feel, Blightcaller? Dead, he answered dryly, though not quite as much as I was. He spoke with a stranger's voice. The sound was neither the grinding frailty of half-paralyzed vocal cords, nor the vibrant tone of a living man. Not a banshee's voice, though it rang with a bit of that command. Sylvanas' eyes shone bright. Rise, champion. He swung his legs off the side of the stone ritual table. A slight gasp escaped his lips as he stood, steadying himself on limbs that didn't quite feel his own. Like a child unwrapping a gift, he yanked the glove from his left hand and stared in awe as he flexed his fingers. There was no protruding bone, no dangling flesh or torn muscles, not a living hand, but it was whole and strong. A hand worthy of the Queen's champion, Nefanos decided. He reached up and touched his cheek. Instead of the desiccated, paper-thin skin that had hung loosely from his skull, he now found plumper flesh. His fingertips explored a jawline adorned with wiry whiskers. Nefanos marveled at the sensation. It felt almost like touching a human. Almost. He turned to Sylvanas. How do I look? He tried to sound as if the question meant nothing to him, but it did. Such vanity, Blightcaller. Amusement laced her voice, but he sensed delight in it as well. Was she pleased that the mighty Valkyr had been bent to her will, or was she simply relishing the acquisition of a new toy? She guided him towards a large oval mirror that hung in an ornate frame upon the wall. See for yourself. As Ranger General of Silvermoon, Sylvanas had indulged a fondness for mirrors, and why not? Even by high elven standards, the second of the three Windrunner sisters had been a very rare beauty. Lords from countless noble houses had sought her hand. Even Prince Sunstrider was said to have desired it. But the dead had little use for reflections. They served only to remind the Forsaken of their gruesome appearance. The decayed flesh that made the other races convulse in disgust. The undead personified the inescapable fate that awaited all the living, that one day their bodies would lie rotting in the ground, unless, of course, called into the Banshee Queen's service. Sylvanas still kept a few mirrors in a hall, of course, though the classic elegance she once possessed had been lost in death. Her undead form held a dark allure that Nephanos found captivating. Even among her hated rivals in the mortal kingdoms, he knew full well there were hypocrites who, while publicly decrying her reign and scorning the Forsaken, in private exchanged fascinated whispers about the Dark Lady. And though she would never allow them to see it, he suspected some long-buried part of her relished such attention. Nephanos stared into the mirror. His face was yellowed and gaunt, but the flesh appeared intact. For the first time since his death, he stood straight and tall, not hunched and stooped like some decrepit elder. If not for the crimson glow of his eyes, the dim light of the Undercity might have allowed him to be mistaken for a human. It pleased him, this transfiguration, but he saw no reason to let Sylvanas know. "It will do, I suppose." He watched her smile fade for a moment, replaced by a flash of anger, and then the return of satisfaction. "You will vanquish 1,000 demons in your queen's name," she proclaimed. His instincts told him she was right. His newfound strength would serve her well in the war to come. And after their victory, if he was very, very lucky, they would die their true deaths and welcome damnation together. Then it struck him that the visage he looked upon was not entirely his own. He turned towards a second ritual table, empty save for a bit of ash and a few stains of oily residue. The paladin's armaments, once diligently polished, lay scuffed and strewn about the floor. Nephanos told himself they were merely the detritus of a fallen enemy, only that and nothing more. "You've clung to the tattered vestments of your former life long enough," the Dark Lady pronounced, and he knew it to be true. Why had he kept the same filthy uniform he'd worn as a man, as a scourge? Was it that he simply didn't care enough to be bothered with donning new armor? Or had he taken comfort in a remnant of his past? Sylvanas gestured toward a shadowed corner, and for the first time he noticed the Dark Ranger stationed at the periphery of the chamber. The Banshee Queen was clever, keeping an archer at hand to put him down. Had the Valkyr spell gone awry? "Anya, escort my champion to the armory and see that he's outfitted in a manner that befits his station." The Dark Ranger silently obeyed, gesturing for Nephanos to lead the way. He nodded to Sylvanas as he left the room, her features caressed by a faint glow of the lamplight. After winding back through the secret tunnels, the pair traversed a long corridor that opened up into the outer ring encircling the Undercity. Entering the common area, Nephanos soon recognized a disadvantage of a new form. Like his other faculties, his sense of smell had grown stronger. As a group of three Forsaken approached, the stench of their rotted flesh brought him near to retching. He hadn't noticed the scent of death after waking from the ritual, but out here, amongst thousands of undead, the odor pummeled him in waves. Nephanos steeled himself until the trio passed, then swore a silent oath that he would never allow himself to be caught off guard that way again. If Anya perceived his weakness, she made no mention of it when she spoke. "I haven't seen the Dark Lady displeased in a long while." The moment she realized the Valkyr were capable of such a ritual, she called for you.
"Our queen is wise," he answered with a nod. "This body better allows me to serve her."
Anya chuckled, a sound that raised the hackles on his neck.
"You disagree?"
he snapped. At least his temper hadn't been altered by the Valkyr.
"It's not that,"
she shrugged.
"What then?"
He all but shouted the words, for the Dark Ranger seemed far too pleased with herself for his liking. She sighed.
"Yes, the queen now has a mightier champion, but that wasn't what she most desired."
He stopped walking and faced her.
Nephanos narrowed his eyes, infuriated by her evasiveness.
"Say what you mean."
The corners of Anya's lips rose in a brazen curl.
Sylvanas defied a kingdom to name you Ranger Lords. She scoured the Plague Lands to reclaim you from the Scourge. And today, she drew upon her most precious resource to restore your strength. Think upon these things, Blightcaller, and tell me how someone so cunning could be so blind to the simplest of truths. Nephanos glared hard at her, his jaw clenched tight. Within moments, the bemusement retreated from her face. Foolish Ranger. The Queen did not entertain such trifle notions, nor did he. Whatever emotion his mortal heart might have held, now it had room only for rage and contempt. He was Nephanos Blightcaller, champion of the Banshee Queen. He almost smiled at the thought of the chaos that he would unleash upon her foes. He resumed walking, Anya following in admonished silence. The distant clash of steel against steel grew into a cacophonous din as they entered the war quarter. Trainers barked at a fresh batch of newly raised recruits, hacking away at target dummies and the occasional Alliance prisoner. Nephanos had spent countless hours transforming such neophytes into hardened soldiers, and it took him no more than a glance to judge this crop to be particularly pathetic. He scowled, vowing to correct their incompetence, then continued to the outfitter's hall. The chamber stone walls were lined with rows of tall racks, each stacked high with equipment and weaponry. Nephanos sought out a mix of mail and leather that would afford ample protection without hindering his movements. He chose pieces of green and grey to conceal him in both forest and shadow. As he turned to leave, the glinting of lamplight on polished metal, it drew his eyes to a cluttered armored rack. He moved a few pieces aside to reveal a finely wrought breastplate that was clean and well-maintained. His thoughts drifted back to the ritual, to the empty altar next to his, to a choice. For the briefest of moments, he felt the touch of something foreign, unsettling, a sensation absent since the day that he died, a weakness of mortality that had stalked him and had at long last found his throat. Nephanos felt regrets.